In heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Good morning and welcome to St. David's United Church in West Vancouver. I'm the Reverend Dal McCrindle, Supply Minister here. And wherever you happen to be, we welcome you. We are joined this morning by Kimberley United Church. And in the welcome this morning at the beginning of the service, we had Daniel Bailey, who's the music director at Kimberley United Church, singing the Lord's Prayer. And hope you appreciated that. On the piano and the cello this morning is Ashton Lim. And wherever you happen to be, whether you're close by or far away, we are glad you've taken the time to join us for worship and the praise of God and seeing what Jesus is calling us to be and do in our lives. In the sanctuary, we are on the unceded territory, the Coast Salish people. We are grateful for the traditional custodians, the Squamish and Tsleil-Waututh nations. Mary Hammond is going to be the lector this morning. Lynn lit the candle, and she will be assisting me in the communion liturgy. Oh, by the way, we are celebrating communion this morning, so if during one of the hymns you might need to sneak to the kitchen to get some bread or something like that and some beverage, that you can join us in sharing the elements. Though we be separated, we are pulled together. We come together. That's what communion means, coming together. On the camera is, again, Jordan Chong. We're grateful to him and the Shore Church. And the technician this morning is Leanne Gillus. And our choir, we have extra because our lector has joined us. So we have Mandy, Melinda, Mary, Jan, and John, who's here for a meeting later. So he thought he would join the choir. And they are social distancing, I assure you. So, welcome to worship. We'll begin with Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You.
Oh,
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Praise the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song. Let Israel be glad in its Maker. Praise God's name with dancing, making melody. For the Lord takes pleasure in the people. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy. Let there be praises to God. Let the people rejoice. Let us pray. Almighty God, under whose care we live and move and have our being, we come into your presence with joy and apprehension, joyful for what we have received and apprehensive for what it is that you might call us to do. We feel compelled to come to your holy places, but fear that you might change us. Send your Holy Spirit upon us that we might become courageous and faithful in your ways, and that we might also know that you are with us throughout whatever you might call us to say, do, and be. Amen. Let us join together in saying the prayer of confession. Patient God, too often we forget whose we are and fail to treat others as you expect. We excuse ourselves because we do try to follow the example of Jesus. We do try to hold high moral standards and behavior, but need to confess that often our trying fails us. We see the failures of others as greater than our own, and too often withhold the forgiveness needed to restore right relationships. Forgive us and create a right spirit within us through Christ, we do pray. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thanks to God for such an assurance as this. Amen.
Good morning. The first reading is from Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 to 14. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. Hear the witness of the Torah.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18, verses 15 to 20. If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. Hear the witness of the gospel.
Praise be to you, Lord God Jesus Christ.
Is love divine.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Speak, Lord, in the stillness while we wait on thee. Hushed our hearts, listen in expectancy. Speak, O blessed Master, in this quiet hour. May we see thy face, Lord, and feel thy touch of power. Amen. Well, now that Labor Day weekend is here, and some of the kids will be going back to school this week, albeit with social distancing, masks, and hand sanitation, things will sort of get back to normal. Well, a new normal. After this summer's hiatus and the COVID-19 sequestering, friends will be able to reconnect with one another and, sadly, in a very short while, former rivalries will return as those students compete with one another over issues of academics, athletics, and power politics. Oh yes, politics can be found on the school playground as well as in the boardrooms and the inner strategy halls of the movers and shakers of society. When disrespect, prejudice, selfishness dominate life, it doesn't take very long for children to start acting like adults, fighting and squabbling about who is better than whom, who is stronger, better looking, smarter, richer, more popular, more deserving of attention. Sometimes, sadly, children can be very cruel to one another, just as adults can. You know, children learn from adults, as grown-ups learn from children. Throughout the long story of humanity, there have been struggles, injustices, fights, wars. All who could see who would end up on top and run the show. One cynic has described human existence as a complex board game like Monopoly, and at the end, whoever ends up with most toys wins. The trouble is that in the process of acquiring today's toys, suffering, starvation, and death are the byproducts. One sarcastic t-shirt I saw a while back had emblazoned on the front, "Whoever ends up with the most toys still dies." The story from Exodus can be heard in a similar way, and if we're not careful, our spiritual message sounds like the chiding of children on playgrounds. Our God is better than your God. Our way of understanding the truth is better than your way. As a matter of fact, not only is my way better than your way leads nowhere. In addition to the destruction caused by the greed of power-hungry dictators over the centuries, the intolerance, insensitivity, and narrow-mindedness of childish adults has fostered religious disagreement, conflict, and even war. If we are tempted to criticize the unbelievable actions of the hostile factions in Israel, Palestine, or India, Pakistan, India, and China, let us be reminded not only of our own behavior, but of our religious heritage, which has sort of shouted, "Our God is better than yours." Now, a metaphor is sort of like a freight train rumbling across the nation. Its service is useful, but at some point you have to get off the train, leaving the metaphor behind, because it's too full of useless and misleading freight. So too with Scripture, sadly, especially the story of the Passover that Mary read today. Not a very encouraging passage if you're an Egyptian. Since last week's reading, Moses has left the burning bush. He's journeyed to Egypt, enjoyed a reunion with brother and sister, confronted the king of Egypt, demanding the liberation of all of the Hebrews. 9 signs or plagues have already been unleashed on the Egyptians, but Pharaoh remains unrepentant. He will not let the people go. Finally, Aaron and Moses are instructed to sacrifice lambs for the evening meal, taking the blood and daubing it on round the doorposts of their homes, and wait for the angel of death to pass through the land, sparing those where blood can be seen. But where there is no blood, the firstborn, both animal and human, would die. Throughout the drama, Pharaoh and Moses have been in conflict as to whose God was stronger. And while that may be true, it is not the emphasis of Exodus. Israel understood salvation, the survival of their firstborn, their liberation and deliverance, to be in the hand of God. God, who was trusted once, could be trusted again and again. The details of their escape are clouded by metaphor, imagery, and legend. We do not know which came first, the observance of something called Passover or their liberation from slavery. It may be that the Feast of Unleavened Bread associated with Passover was maybe even from another tradition, as it appears to be written by a different author. We don't know what the death of the firstborn was all about or whether it really happened. One would think that something as calamitous as the universal death of all the firstborn of the strongest nation in the world would have been noted somewhere and not just in the cultic remembrances and legends of an ambitious people. No, the story of Passover is not about death. It is a story about life. It is the story of a belief that God can and will ultimately save faithful people, no matter what the obstacles. For if we push Passover's metaphorical language farther than we should, what does it really say about a God of creation, a God of love, a God of understanding who would stand by while thousands of innocent kids are killed? What does it say to Palestinians, Lebanese, Syrians, Jordanians, and Egyptians who are being urged by the world community to negotiate peace with a nation who remembers and celebrates every year the death of their children of antiquity? I personally don't believe in a God who slaughters infants nor anyone else, nor in a God who expects us to believe that we have a monopoly on God's time and that God is not able to be known by others through different metaphors, experiences, revelations. Israel remembered something about their escape, deliverance, and liberation in faith language, in metaphors, and in legends. It remained a constant metaphor to describe their experience of God who would deliver them and anyone else who might hear and trust by seeking new life rather than old death. Much later in history, theologians in Israel struggled with the narrowness and insensitivity of this text by writing a midrash or commentary on the Passover legend that actually describes God weeping bitterly as the innocent died. Now, just as the Exodus passage has been misused to pronounce superiority, the passage from Matthew has also been used to support the ganging up on people. This time, though, it's not my God is better than your God, but our idea or point of view is better than yours. God must be on our side of these issues because collectively we agree that God is on our side. Remember, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. But just as the emphasis of the Exodus passage is about deliverance and life rather than suffering and death, the emphasis of Matthew is not about power, rightness, or dominance, but where there is two or more gathered in Christ's name, Christ is there among them. Nowhere does Matthew say that the two or three have to agree, only to be gathered together in his name. Then there's possibilities for grace, hearing, growth, understanding. In another place, according to the Apostle Paul, Christians should owe no one anything except to love one another. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. So whether we are engaged in theological dialogue with other faiths or dealing with conflict, disagreement, or hurt, our guiding principle is not that our God is better or that we might be right. The demand of God who has and will deliver us from slavery and bondage is to love our neighbor as ourself. At least that's the way I see it. The sacrament of Holy Communion. This is not St. David's table. It's not mine. It's not even collectively ours. This is Jesus' table. And we're all invited, all, wherever we be. Even if you're far away, the other side of the country, in your living room, you are joining us in this table. So, let us begin. May God be with us. God is here among us. Let us open our hearts to God. We open them to God and to one another. Let us give thanks to God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Our hymn is We Are One.
Why do we give thanks and praise at this table?
We give thanks because God is always with us. We thank you, God, creator of us all. From the beginning, you made the world and all its creatures. You made people to live for you and for one another. We praise you, O God. We praise you, O God. You created Adam and Eve and gave them a garden. You showed Noah a rainbow. You gave Moses strength to free your people and taught Miriam to sing. You gave courage to Esther and loyalty to Ruth. You gave David a harp to sing your praise and helped him defeat the giant. We praise you, O God.
We praise you, O God.
Yet even they turned away from you and forgot about you as we do too. But you did not forget. You sent Jesus to the world to show how much you love us and to bring us back to you again. We praise you, O God.
We praise you, O God.
He came as one of us, first an infant, then a child, later a youth, then an adult. He rejoiced with those who rejoiced and wept with those who wept. To the despairing, he spoke a word of hope. To the sick, he gave healing. To the hurting, he was a friend. Still, people turned away from you. They betrayed Jesus and nailed him to a cross. But he was lifted from the grave and restored to life, that he might be with us and we with him, alive forevermore. Therefore, with all the saints of every time and place, we join the angels in their praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Why do we eat bread at this table?
We gather at this table to remember that on the night before he died, Jesus ate with his friends. He took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Each time you do this, remember me."
Why do we drink from the cup at this table?
That same night, Jesus also took a cup, and after giving thanks, passed it to his friends, saying, "Drink. This cup poured out for you is the promise of God. Whenever you drink it, remember me."
What do we remember at this table?
We remember Jesus' death and celebrate his resurrection. We await with hope his coming again to bring peace and justice to the earth. And we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
From whom do we pray at this table?
We pray for God's world. We pray for all who are in the grip of sin and temptation, for those who are blinded by greed or power, for those who are alone or feel abandoned, for those who languish in jail or refugee camp or compound, for those on the margins of society, the poor, the misunderstood, the oppressed, the lonely, disfigured, unemployed or abused. We pray for those of the workforce, those who labor that our lives might be sustained and protected. We are grateful for meaningful employment and pray that all might be treated with respect, fairness, and dignity. We pray for those who are unable to work, unable to find employment. Help us work together for a society where all people might have a sense of worth. Gracious God, your love is clear and consuming. Hear our prayers. Now, O God, send your Holy Spirit upon us and what we do here, that we in these gifts touched by your Spirit may be signs of life and love to each other and to the world. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, God most holy, now and forever. We offer these prayers in the name of Jesus, whose words we now say and sing. Today we will hear them spoken in German.
Vater unser im Himmel, geheiligt werde dein Name. Dein Reich komme. Dein Wille geschehe wie im Himmel so auf Erden. Unser tägliches Brot gib uns heute und vergib uns unsere Schuld, wie auch wir begeben unsere Schuldigen. Und führe uns nicht in Versuchung, sondern erlöse uns von den Bösen. Denn dein ist das Reich und die Kraft und die Herrlichkeit in Ewigkeit. Amen.
The body of Christ is broken for you. It is for you. The blood of Christ, it is shed for you. For the bread we have eaten, for the wine we have tasted, for the life we have received, we thank you, God. Grant that we become mature Christians, that ours may be the faith that issues in action through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our hymn is O Christian Love. Thank you. And now let us go out and let forgiveness be the pattern in our life, our discipline, our testimony, that all might know that God loves them too. And now may the blessings of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be yours this day and always. Amen.
Thank you.